Let's take a look at the two half cells that have been coupled to produce this galvanic cell or electrochemical cell. The half cell equations are given at the bottom in blue and red. On the right we have the hydrogen half cell involving hydrogen ions and hydrogen molecules, and on the left a half cell involving two different oxidation states, chromium 3+ and 2+. Take a look then at the reduction potentials for these two half cells. The one in blue, from chromium 3 to chromium 2+, has the smaller reduction potential, -0.41, compared with 0.00, of course, for the standard hydrogen half cell. So we'll look at the equation in blue at the bottom left, and you'll see I reverse it to show it as an oxidation instead, and I change the sign of the E theta value from minus to plus, +0.41 volts. On the right in red, the standard hydrogen half cell has the larger reduction potential at 0.00 volts. And reduction potentials are exactly that, the potential to undergo reduction. The larger the value, the more likely it is to undergo reduction when coupled with another half cell. So on the right, we have reduction of hydrogen ions to hydrogen gas. And on the left, we have oxidation, chromium 2+ in solution to chromium 3+ in solution. And to work out the EMF, the electromotive force or potential difference, we simply add those E theta values together, and that gives us a value of +0.41 volts. And do bear in mind that the EMF must always be positive for a galvanic cell. If it turns out to be negative, then an error has been made. The two half cells have been coupled back to front. In order to use the standard E theta values or reduction potentials, the galvanic cell must comply with standard conditions. So let's take a look at what they are. The solution in the beaker on the left is 1 mole per cubic decimeter with respect to both Cr2+ and Cr3+, and is at a temperature of 298K. As neither of these oxidation states of chromium is a metal, we need to use an inert metal to conduct electrons in and out of the solution. In this case, the inert metal is platinum. It serves as the anode. Turning to the right-hand half cell, again, the solution is 1 mole per cubic decimeter with respect to hydrogen ions, for example, 1 molar hydrochloric acid solution, and it will be at a temperature of 298K, 25 degrees C. And in a gas cell, such as this one, the hydrogen half cell, the gas will be at 1 atmosphere pressure, which should be written as 1 by 10 to the 5 pascals, and a temperature of 298K. 25 degrees centigrade. The gas cell also has a platinum wire connected at the bottom to a platinum foil, onto which the hydrogen gas bubbles and hydrogen ions are attracted to pick up electrons and undergo reduction to form H2 molecules. Next then, let's consider what's happening inside each of these half cells. So I turn to look at the half cell on the left, the chromium 2+, chromium 3+ half cell. Notice how chromium 2+ ions arriving at the platinum anode undergo oxidation. That's to say, they each give up one electron, undergo oxidation, and form chromium 3+. The electrons generated by this oxidation move upwards and in a clockwise direction through the external circuit. Then moving to the right-hand side and to the standard hydrogen half cell, looking at the platinum plate there, and you'll see hydrogen ions arrive, pick up electrons that have arrived through the external circuit from the anode. They form hydrogen atoms that then pair up to form hydrogen molecules, so H2 gas is produced. Here in the galvanic cell, just as in electrolysis, oxidation takes place at the anode and reduction takes place at the cathode. You will, however, notice that the anode is labelled as the negative electrode and the cathode as the positive electrode. And that, of course, is different to how the anode and cathode are labelled in electrolysis. And this, it seems, traces back to Benjamin Franklin's original error in thinking that electricity was a flow of positive charge. So much literature had been written by the time the error was discovered, that it was decided to simply overcome the matter by labelling the anode negative rather than positive, and the cathode positive rather than negative. So this is what you're to learn regarding a galvanic cell. Remember that the anode's to be labelled negative and the cathode labelled positive. Next, let's consider the role of the salt bridge. The salt bridge will contain a simple salt solution, such as sodium nitrate or potassium chloride. Without a salt bridge, a galvanic cell will run for only a short time. The role of the salt bridge is to counterbalance an imbalance in charge that begins to build up in both of the half cells. Let's consider why. In the left-hand half cell, Cr2 plus ions are changing into Cr3 plus ions. That means there's a build-up of positive charge there, and that's counterbalanced by negative ions from the salt bridge, for example, chloride ions or nitrate ions, entering into that half cell to balance the positive charge that's building up. In this animation, the pink spheres represent the negative ions, chloride or nitrate ions. Now look at the right-hand half cell. Here, hydrogen ions are leaving the solution. So there's a drop in positive charge. Again, this is counterbalanced by positive ions from the salt bridge, for example, potassium or sodium ions, entering the solution to balance the depletion of H plus ions. And in this animation, it's the green spheres that represent the positive ions from the salt bridge. It is important that the ions present in the salt bridge are neither discharged at the electrodes nor react with any of the ions present in the solutions in the half cells. And this is what makes sodium and potassium salts particularly suited. As they enter the right-hand half cell, there's no risk that they're going to undergo reduction in competition with hydrogen ions because they have very low reduction potentials. And it's what makes chloride and nitrate ions suitable because they form soluble salts, so there's no risk of any precipitation reactions taking place. In summary then, on the left-hand side, at the anode, we have chromium 2 plus ions undergoing oxidation to form chromium 3 plus ions. All of that is taking place in solution. The electrons that are produced by that oxidation of Cr2 plus pass through the external circuit in a clockwise direction through a high resistance voltmeter that records a voltage of 0.41 volts if the conditions are standard conditions. Those electrons pass to the cathode, where they will build up on the platinum foil, making it negative. Don't let that confuse you with the fact that the cathode is always labelled the positive electrode. But in effect, it has electrons build up on its surface, which attracts in the positive hydrogen ions. Those hydrogen ions accept electrons to form atoms. The atoms pair up to form H2 molecules, so hydrogen gas is formed at the cathode, a reduction reaction. The role of the salt bridge is to counterbalance A, the buildup of positive charge on the left, and B, the drop in positive charge on the right. This happens because negative ions, such as chloride ions or nitrate ions, move from the salt bridge towards the left and into the left-hand half cell to counterbalance the buildup of positive charge. While positive ions, sodium or potassium ions for example, move in to the right-hand half cell to counterbalance the depletion of positive charge, the depletion of hydrogen ions. Note that the standard hydrogen half cell on the right is known as the conventional half cell. In order to work out the reduction potential of any other half cell, the other half cell is always coupled with the standard hydrogen half cell. In the event that the hydrogen half cell undergoes reduction rather than oxidation, as is the case here, then the other half cell that has been coupled to it must have a lower reduction potential. And as is the case here with Cr2+/Cr3+, the voltage will give the reduction potential for that other half cell. However, if the other half cell has undergone oxidation, then we do need to change the sign of the voltage, in this case, to minus 0.41 volts. So the reduction potential for the Cr3+ to Cr2+ half cell is minus 0.41 volts. Then in the other scenario, where the other half cell coupled to the standard hydrogen half cell is the one that undergoes reduction, then we can see that it has a larger reduction potential than the hydrogen half cell, so it will have a positive E theta value. So in this case, the voltage will directly give the E theta value, or reduction potential, for that other half cell. So that's it. I hope you found that useful. This is one of several videos that I've prepared on the topic of electrochemistry.